my favorite quarterback. I'm going to listen to him speak, and then I go home a happy man and kill myself. So you went in to hear Terry Bradshaw, Terry Bradshaw testimony, and Terry Bradshaw started talking about Jesus. When he got to talking about Jesus, he said Terry Bradshaw had another game, he had to leave. He said, I was sitting there, Professor, and I started to leave. I wanted to leave. Got up three times to leave, but something wouldn't let me leave. Wow. He didn't know what it was. I know it was the Holy Ghost. Couldn't leave. And so preacher said he started preaching. And when he started preaching, he just shared the good news. Just start talking about Jesus. And the good news of Christ. He said, when he got through, they extended the invitation, and about 90 plus people came down the aisle. But that man was still upstairs and wouldn't go. And he said, if something preacher said he didn't have his notes, he know he didn't even do it. But he said, the Spirit is telling me there's still somebody. Which I had. And the man, he swore. He said, when those people start going down the aisle, he said, why are all these people going down there about a Jesus they don't even know? About somebody they haven't even seen. What's wrong with them people? But the preacher said, somebody is still out there. He said, you know, Pastor, when you said that, I swear, it looks like you're looking right at me. And he said, when he got through saying that, even one other person came down that aisle. He was sitting in the last seat that are way up there on the top, and he walked all the way down from that row, all the way down the aisle, and gave his life to Jesus. Gave his life to Jesus, and said, Professor, when he came, he said, Professor, I don't know anything. I don't know a whole lot about church. I don't have a whole lot of church history. All I know is I love Jesus. And Pastor is about to start a new members class, and he says, I'm going to start that new members class, a pastor Sunday school class. He said, well, I'm going to start a pastor Sunday school class. I want you to head that class for me. Get some folk. He said, that man got to work and witness him, and he filled that class up with like 70 plus people. And he said, it wasn't long after a few years when the Lord touched him. He said, well, Pastor, I quit my job, and I'm going to be an evangelist. That's why he lost his mind. He said, no, the Lord put in my spirit to be an evangelist. He said, the Lord just started blessing his life. He just started leading folk to Christ. Yeah. Had a prosperous ministry, was doing a great work. Some years later, his wife called him and says, Pastor, Russell, so he died 3 days ago. He said, well, Pastor, I want you to know something. That before he died, he died of lung cancer. He got to the point where he couldn't go 60 seconds without a breathing machine. He said, but the last few breaths he had, he used to witness to his nurse and mother to Christ. Y'all don't get it, y'all don't get it. And you ought to always be ready to have a reason. See, sometimes you're so busy focusing on your cancer, you don't know how God can use you to witness through your cancer. Sometimes you're always focusing on your bad luck and your bad circumstances. And you understand, with God, there is no luck. With God, you got to learn how to lean and depend. Come on here, somebody. God will see you through. It's not all about you. It's really all about God. If you stop focusing on yourself and start focusing on Him, that verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, he says He's the God of all comfort. That means I don't care what you're going through, God can comfort you. But then he said, but look here, if you read on, he tell you, but God will comfort you. Come on here, with the comfort of somebody else. Y'all missing. God comforts you by the testimony of those who have already been comforted. In other words, he says it's a two-way street. God is a God of all comfort, but if you want to be comforted, you first got to learn how to comfort. And when you comfort somebody else, God will see to it that somebody will comfort you. I've learned you go to church, the folk in the hospital, and they can be dying, or they can have a serious disease, or they just going through something, and you go there to comfort them, but when you leave, they end up comforting you more than you ought to have had a witness here. That's why He's a God of all comfort. That you learn, if you stop throwing the pity parties and just try to plant a seed, if you stop throwing the pity parties and just witness to somebody, if you stop throwing the pity parties, yes, I'm going through a picture of where you want to be. Do I have a witness here? Help me, mighty face. Let me close this thing out. He says, brightness beyond the bitterness. Then you need to be who God wants you to be. Because you need to be ready to witness. You need to be ready to tell somebody who Jesus is. You need to be ready to tell them that God is able. You need to be ready to tell them that if it wasn't for the Lord, I wouldn't be where I am. Don't worry about life being unfair. You see, sometimes we spend too much time asking why. Instead of asking, Lord, what's the next step? All through scripture, you see that a lot of times God allowed something that was unfair. What was fair about Job's situation? Job wasn't fair. Job was minding his own business. In fact, Job's biggest crime was that he was a faithful man. The devil said, I'm going to and fro, seeking whom I may devour. It was God that said, have you considered, almost I had a witness, my servant Job. And the Bible declared that the devil started raining turmoil on Job's life. And when he started, he said, the Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Yeah, Job's life wasn't fair when his cattle died, when his camels died, when his horses were all dead, when he lost everything he had, it wasn't fair. But he said, the Lord give it, and the Lord had taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Naked I came into this world, and naked I will depart. I'm going to lean on the Lord. He's able to carry you through. Do I have a witness here? Job will tell you, even though it's rough, the Bible said he never stopped trusting in the Lord. When his wife told him to curse God and die, yet he still trusted God. He might have had some bad days. He might not talk right all the time, but he always leaned and depended on the Lord. Then let me close out and talk about resurrection hope. Job had what I call resurrection hope. The Bible declared that the devil threw him down, but after he threw him down, God raised him up. And the Bible said he restored fourfold everything that he lost. I'm just trying to tell you that you got to have faith in God's resurrection power. Some of y'all still don't see it. Well, look at Stephen. Stephen wasn't exactly treated fair. What Stephen did was that he talked about the Lord. He bragged about Jesus. And you know the story. They took him out and they stoned him to death. But Stephen found the secret of blessings beyond bitterness. Because the Bible declared while he was dying, he said, I see something. I see Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father. Y'all know the story. He said, my Father, don't lay this deed to their charge. Forgive them. In other words, they don't know what they're doing. He didn't die with his last words of cussing folk out. He didn't die talking about how trifling they were. But he said, Lord, have mercy on them. Because I see what I need to see. I see Jesus standing on the right hand of the Father. Y'all missed it. Yes. Remember I told you, the old preacher said Jesus is sitting on the right hand of the Father. That's what the Bible says. He's sitting on the right hand of God. But Stephen said, I see him standing up. Somebody said, that must not be Jesus. He's supposed to be sitting down. But then somebody said, well, he sits down and things are normal. But when you start messing with one of his children, he stands up. He sits down and things are all right. But when you start trying to mess with one of his servants, he'll stand up and come to the rescue. Just like somebody said, he may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. I close it now. But all I'm trying to tell you is you want brightness beyond the bitterness. If you want to be able to act like child of God when the storm comes. Not only must you need righteous hope, not only do you need ready, reasonable hope, but you need some resurrection hope. And notice I didn't say resurrected hope. I'm not talking about hope that was down and then resurrected. No, you got to have hope in the resurrection. You got to have hope in the fact that God raised him up. Because Jesus, he didn't